Hello everyone, this is Got Somme, a wine podcast that first season tried to find the best bottle of wine under $30. In season 2, 2023, we are now chatting to the people who create the wine, the people behind the magic in the glass. And when it comes to Australian winemakers, if there was a Hall of Fame, this person would be the person who picks the people in the Hall of Fame at the top of the food pyramid. It's a pleasure and honour to sit next to this person and have you so early on in season 2 of Got Somme. Phillip Jones, welcome to the podcast.
Thank you very much. I've never heard such glowing words before.
It all goes downhill from here.
Oh, thanks.
Of course, we should, like I said, no introduction, but for maybe someone who hasn't heard of you, of course, the most premium Pinot Noir in Australia is, of course, Bass Phillip, and that is, of course, your namesake.
That's, well, sort of.
Yeah, yes. Half namesake.
In fact, it originates from George Bass and Arthur Phillip, who were explorers in the region. And there are so many physical, you know, there's physical evidence of that everywhere. Bass Strait, Port Phillip Bay, the Bass River, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And Governor Arthur Phillip, of course. So he just happened to have the same name as me.
It
worked out all right.
So we're going to pour a glass of wine before next episode, diving deep into it. Which one would you like to start with, do you think?
The one that's 2015 vintage.
Yep.
That's that one.
The estates.
Yeah. On the next episode, we will be trying the 2010 premium Pinot Noir, which is the upper echelon of wine, not just in your category, but just in general in the world.
So briefly, the wines we have to talk about later are from two different vineyards. They were both entirely planted and developed by myself and my wife, and the first wine, we call it Issan, named after a region in northeast Thailand. I won't bore you with the detail, excepting that it's a very infertile part of South Gippsland, which is so fertile with high rainfall and deep soils. The second wine is from our original property, planted in 1979, so the premium Pinot Noir and its bigger brother, the Reserve, are still rated right at the top of the list of Australian Pinots.
Of course they are. Well, cheers.
Cheers,
great
indeed.
Great to have you on the podcast. Mm-hmm. Look forward to talking more about what's in the glass in front of us as we enjoy it right now on the next episode. But if you don't mind me jumping in, Carlos, and just saying, can you take us back to how you ended up a winemaker?
I'm an engineer by training. And I was always interested in the future, in research and development. So I became a research engineer in the telecom, in those days, research laboratories. There wasn't much opportunity for engineers to go out and start their own business and build something. So this frustrated me like hell. So after about 10 years of sitting over dinner tables with my friends who they found their direction. Well, they became professors and heads of mathematics departments and likewise. And so all the nerds used to get together with their wives or girlfriends over dinner and play guessing games with wine. Anyone who's developed an interest in wine has sort of developed a skill at this options games, guessing games, and we all try to outdo each other and without any cheating. It's all straight and honest. But, for example, we might say, well, this wine, was the Christian name of this wine's maker Harold, George or Bill, you know, and we'd contest these things for wines all over the world. So it was a totally nerdy, crazy game that we played. I discovered that I had a skill in
blind tasting.
In picking some flavours that others couldn't. Mm. And when there was a wine that was exceptionally different, I would ring the maker up and ask him why.
What did you do?
Yeah, what happened? And one of the most common, and I won't labour this at great length, but one of the most common ones was when there was more texture and power in the wine, it was the year in which the poor grower had suffered a frost. Mm. And that means that the crop produced in that season was somewhere between a quarter and a half of the normal. So the brain went ticking into gear and I started to look at what happens in Europe where they have appellation control systems, labelling control systems, which necessitate a certain lower level of cropping. In that case, it's measured in hectolitres per hectare, but and we do our measurements here in in tons per acre, but I was fascinated by this parameter, which no one ever talked about, which was grams of fruit per vine, because the vine density, the density of the closeness of the vines, has a big influence on the end result. If you're looking at the major attributes of great wine, intensity of flavour, texture, and length or persistence. So that was my little research project from there on. And I thought, well, I'm never going to start a business making electronic, you know, data communication systems, so I'm going to have a go at wine. So then I spent 5 years studying. Well, I wanted to make Bordeaux. You're correct. I thought my benchmark was going to be Chateau du Cru Bocayu. And for those of you who are unfamiliar, that was in the second level of the Great Bordeaux five-level classification system. I didn't target one of the top because I just thought, well, you know, that's a bit presumptuous. You know, how can I make Margaux or Latour Brion, or something? Yeah. And I loved those wines that were made principally from Cabernet Sauvignon.
You were humble enough to pick at the Cru Bocayu.
That's it. That's it. And it's always a great drink. And right. So, and I actually went there 1 year and I just fell in love with the place. And that's not the first time that's happened to someone in this country. And so I planted most of this 10-acre block that I purchased in those days, 10 acres, for $14,000. I remember distinctly. Wow. Now, you couldn't buy a garage shed to put on it for that today.
With one of those down at Brighton Beach, one of those little huts are like 350 grand.
Yeah, that's right. Crazy.
Jesus, 14 grand for 10 acres?
But prior to that, I studied 110 years of weather data because I set up 12 criteria. It was a really nerdy sort of mathematical analysis
study. And that's the engineering of you.
No, that was the engineering brain. Really got a great – I got so much satisfaction part of the process. I should have just given up then. And then when I reached the age I am now, I'd be able to walk properly. 90% of it to the grape varieties used in this particular chateau in Bordeaux in the same percentages. Now, that is really insane behaviour. That's extreme. And I planted 3 rows of Pinot Noir and 5 rows of Chardonnay because in those days, which was late 1970s, Pinot Noir and Chardonnay were not well known in Australia. And I thought, well, you know, I might be missing out something here. I better plant a few and see how it goes. The first wine from Pinot Noir that I made, which was about one barrel, 200 odd litres, because there's only a small patch of vines, I took it to – I used to live in South Yarra and around the corner from the fellow who started the Francois restaurant in South Yarra. Mm-hmm. So we became great mates.
Jean-Paul?
Yvonne Vogel was the man. There are three partners, and Jean-Paul was one of the first two partners of Yvonne. But Yvonne was the entrepreneur and loved food and wine. But his uncle had a vineyard in southern Burgundy. And I walked into his – he had a cheese shop opposite on the corner of South Caroline Street in the early days before he started Francois. And I walked in there with my red mud all over my boots one day, and he said – where you been? And I said, nobody knew about it. I said, I've been in my vineyard. And he's, my uncle got a vineyard. Anyway, to stop the story there, I gave him a couple of bottles. And he tried to ring me every day for a fortnight to let me know, this was the best Pinot Noir he'd ever tasted in Australia. And what he said literally was about the Cabernet Sauvignon varieties, which more my blood, sweat and everything and money had gone into in planting them. He says, don't you waste your bloody time with this other bloody rubbish. Just rip it out and stick to Pinot. Good, first advice, you know. And I did. And so it went from there.
Wow.
And 10 years later, I sold the first bottle of wine. 12 years later.
Wow.
So is that an insane story. So yes, what was I doing story, in the meantime? Yeah. Twiddling my thumbs, you know. But we lived off a very small level of funding, and I didn't dare go out to borrow money because I chose this site. I didn't finish that part of the story, but I chose this site based on a study of Burgundy and Bordeaux climatic and soil factors, even going back into the 1870s, because I found in the archives at Melbourne University, right upstairs in the Bayleu Library, these tomes from the Municipalité de Bordeaux, which gave all this technical data. So I got to it, analysing things, and those were the days when you went to the Met Bureau, for example, in Melbourne, to get detail on the last 100 years of weather data. It was on sheets of computer paper this wide and that long, with holes down the sides.
There wasn't 4 foot by 4 foot.
That's it. And there wasn't any. There weren't any computers or internet or whatever. And so it was a long manual process. And basically, I studied, and I'll go no further than this. It's too much detail, but I studied the mean values of temperature and rainfall and the variances about those means, which is a particular mathematical calculation, for the four windows of time. So I had to average over the four windows of time, otherwise it's too much information. I was already burdened by a lot of information at this point. And so I looked at the four different phases of the growing season for vines and took the averages and means around there and compared them with other great wine – great wine growing regions of Australia and in Europe.
Wow.
So that's where it all started, and I thought that I had my perfect Bordeaux patch, and it wasn't. It was the perfect Burgundy. So there's a load of nonsense for you.
You have the Crown Prince, the estate, the premium, the reserve, and out of a very, very close vineyard, how you manage to, you know, have such different characters out of each of the bottlings, and every single one is very special, very different, and every single one tell a huge different story. But how do you bring that out of the same vineyard almost?
The reserve and premium Pinot Noir always came from the original 1979 vineyard. The estate Pinot Noir, which is the third on the list, has become a blend of the not-so-good part of that vineyard and a large vineyard we planted in 1996 right in the town of Leongatha. Then the Crown Prince was taken from that large vineyard also. So the original vineyard was 10 acres. This new one in 96 was 25 acres. And so then the vineyard called Issan was planted in 1992 and it took us 10 years to get the first crop, 1982. One of my neighbours, local dairy farmer, he shouted to me, "Phil," he's tooting his horn, come, you know, there's a fire. So you know, all the local farmers get together and as members of the Country Fire Authority, the local CFA. And this place was 15 kilometres away, and some highly unintelligent pair of brothers, farmers, had a truck full of square hay bales. And these hay bales were about half a metre away from the top of the pile from the exhaust pipes on the truck. So it was a 38-degree day in January, and the exhaust pipes on the truck set fire to the hay bales. Oh. So one of them, we call them Dad and Dave. Dave crawled out of the front of the truck while they're driving along the main road from Leongatha South to Outram and kicked the burning hay bales off the truck as it went along. That started a fire, a grass fire, every 50 metres for a period of about 5 kilometres. So all hands on deck, we were there with the knapsack sprays. It ended up with this truck, they disconnected a trailer full of hay on the back of the truck and drove home. They're just so irresponsible. And when we got to this point where the trailer had been dismantled, the it was an old truck axle underneath this trailer, and it was white hot.
Mm.
Everything had burned and was melting, and this was in a cutting where the roadside was probably 3 or 4 metres below the soil. So we got there and we were having a bit of a joke about these two idiots who started fires along this road. And I was fixated on the subsoil where this cutting had been cut only a couple of years before.
Mm.
And it reminded me, because this is the sort of thing I did if ever I went to Burgundy, I'd ride around on a bicycle and look at the cuttings soil, yeah. at the edges of vineyards to see what the soil composition was like. And it's a fascinating mixture. People talk about limestone. Well, it's a small percentage limestone. A lot of it's clay, it's rocks and so on. It's all rubble that was dragged by glaciers thousands of years before. So I was looking at this and I thought, gee, this looks like the soil at the top of Clos Saint-Jacques in Gevrey-Chambelle town. So I thought, wow, we've got something here that I hadn't realised. And being 15 kilometres from where I was, where the soil is very rich and it's red or grey ironstone, deep silty loams. And I always tuck this in my head. And when I was looking for more vineyard land, suddenly 10 acres appeared on the market right at this cutting spot, right at this spot.
Perfect.
So I bought it. And that's the result.
Wow. That's it. That's
and it took a long time.
Started from a hay bale fire.
A hay bale fire. Yeah, Dad and Dave.
Wow.
So,
got to be thankful for that fire in the end, don't
absolutely. You? Each of those wines is made in exactly the same way.
Mm.
The only difference in the production process after the harvest is that the top two wines, the Reserve and Premium, have always been stored in 100% new oak.
Mm.
And so the choice of the oak in that case was important. And I wanted oak to be an integrating and balancing medium, not a flavour component.
Mm.
So we always purchased this and so happens to be one of the most expensive and hard to get barrels, Francois Frère. Mm. We always bought lightly toasted oak. Now, the whole subject of oak selection, the toasting of it, the periods of time you use it for, how old the oak is, how long can you keep it for, blah, blah, blah. It's become a science.
Mm.
And it was fascinating. I basically wanted to, it's probably a cop-out. I didn't want to become too embroiled in the technicalities of those things. I wanted to find something that naturally matched what was growing there.
Mm.
And all through the process, and certainly for me, viticulture and the growth of the vines, the way we looked after them, the disposition of the vines, the density of them, blah, 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 has been by far the most important factor in the viticultural process, for example, because it's all just detail upon detail. Mm. We don't irrigate, right? Irrigation just upsets the natural development of flavours and so on in the grapes. And, I went to a college where we all studied irrigation and best ways to do it and how you calculate how many litres of water each vine needs every week and blah, 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 blah. Why don't we just let nature look after that? And nature looks after it very well. One of the concepts that I wasn't really aware of in the early days, in the days when we started planting the vineyard or vineyards, was this European and particularly French concept of terroir, and that is that each plot of land has particular characteristics, whether it be in the soil composition or, the hours of sunlight or the maximum temperatures in summer or blah, 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 blah. It leads to a composition or a selection, a collection of flavours and pattern in the wines that's very identifiable and very distinct and distinctly different from one vineyard site to another, let alone from one region to another.
Mm.
But this terroir, the expression of the taste of the place, is more pronounced in Pinot Noir amongst the red grape varieties. Mm. And you can probably say that it is in Riesling, in the white wine case.
You say Nebbiolo maybe as well?
Or? Oh, Nebbiolo, yes. But Nebbiolo is more dependent on the production process in its style.
Right, extraction.
But and that's a big subject. And incidentally, Nebbiolos are amongst my favourite wines.
Same.
Yeah. So getting back to your question, Carlos, I've merely found a production process that is, you know, the selection of harvest time, the way in which we crush the fruit, whether or not we have whole bunches in the fermentations, and then the temperature of the ferments. Now, I preferred most of those things to take a natural course. So I never controlled the temperature of ferment. The only scientific we'll call it scientific intervention in what would be a natural process was to ensure that the secondary fermentation, the malolactic fermentation, which Carlos can describe.
Now we've learned a lot about malolactic fermentation.
So and the big issue in this regard, which is worth commenting on because I'm not sure that many people are aware of that detail, there are many different lactic acid bacteria which catalyse or encourage this secondary fermentation from malic to lactic acid. And one of them is the family of lactobacilli or lactobacillus, a form of bacillus. Lactobacilli are everywhere in a dairy district. And, you know, they're in your fingernails, in your ears, in your up your nostrils, in your shoes, everywhere, on your dinner plate, and you can't see them. And, of course, these are very useful bacteria in the kind of fermentation of milk into cheeses and so on, which some people have managed to capitalise on. But with wine, the byproduct from a malolactic conversion initiated by lactobacilli are dirty. So there's the one factor which is volatile acidity, or if you like, VA, which is horrible. And another one is a sweet cloying character that you get even in red wines called diacetyl. And so those two byproducts, which are not primary byproducts of the malolactic conversion, the dirty nuances from that. So if we allowed the natural bacteria to dominate, we could have problems. And I noticed that early in the piece. The first, I don't know, 6-8 years of wines, sometimes I had, and I got criticised, you got VA, this is, you know, this is wrong, fix it. And the only way to fix it was to discourage the lactobacilli, and that can be done in a certain chemical way.
It's
basically when you apply sulfur dioxide.
Ah, that's right.
Yeah.
Okay. Of course.
And the other one was to inoculate, and to develop a very active inoculation from laboratory developed lactic acid bacteria, which favour the particular bacterium known as Enococcus, which is the clean one. And so we ended up with not so much of that VA problem in the early days. So, yeah, it's been a long learning process, of course.
Phillip, you're known as quite an eccentric winemaker. Is that fair? Do you find that? Do you find that people think that you're a little bit eccentric?
I have heard this.
Yeah.
Right. Very few people have told me to my face.
I can't. I'm only relaying something I read online.
Well, I was born a Virgo, right? So that makes me pedantic and basically a pain in the butt, right? and people who've worked for me will attest to this.
Might agree.
I've heard of a few, I guess.
Have you really? So, you know, even now that we've just sold the business and all my arms and legs are breaking and all this sort of stuff, and you know, and come 4 to 5 p.m., I can't work anymore. I just, you know, need a drink or something. But I still want to discover new things about wine. So that's just my
enjoy
brain configuration.
And it's. I mean, I remember the last time we were at the estate. We you spoke about the Nebbiolo. Is that still what?
And
it's crazy because no one knows about it.
No, no. Yeah. And of course, the fascinating thing about Nebbiolo is that in Australia, those who've experimented with Nebbiolo, basically, that's where it stands at the moment. But of course, in Italy, I had the opportunity tasting cheese and wine in the Aosta Valley, and I can still remember them well. And very few of those wines come to Australia, but there's one Gattinara, which is more common.
Gattinara Gemme, common Nebbiolos. Yeah.
And
good replacement.
But it's not Barolo, but beautiful wine. So I always had this in mind. Well, we're in a cooler place in South Gippsland. We must be able to get something with that kind of character.
And do they grow? I mean, does it grow close to the Pinot Noir? Because both of them are very hard managing grapes, right?
That is a myth. People talk about Pinot Noir being hard to produce. That is total nonsense. Pinot Noir is much easier to produce in our region there than Cabernet Sauvignon. Cabernet Sauvignon doesn't ripen properly. It's too cool.
It's a lie. I've been told the thin-skinned grape, Pinot Noir, it's the most difficult, hence why it's the most expensive.
And the big issue for Pinot is fungal disease. And the big issue for any nutter who wants to plant Pinot Noir in South Gippsland is fungal disease. And I tell people that fungal disease was invented there. And it's because the rainfall... In many months of the year, it rains every day. It's not far from the sea, unless there's a really strong wind coming in from the sea. If there's a gentle breeze, it's laden with moisture. And so fungal disease just thrives on fertile soil for the plants we're concerned about, and humidity, rainfall, and dews in the morning. In summer, January, say, we can have beautiful sunny days, 30-odd degrees, but until 10 a.m. in the morning, the vineyard canopy, no clouds in the sky, the vineyard canopy is soaking wet with dew, and that's because of proximity to the sea. So if you want to avoid using toxic chemicals, which was one of my plans from the outset, they're the systemics, particularly for managing fungus. It's a challenge. It's a massive challenge. Yeah.
And so you would use a little bit of Bordeaux mixture, copper, sulfate, water.
Well, the standard formula is sulfur. That's powdered sulfur. It's elemental sulfur. And it's not Bordeaux mixture these days. Well, it's related. It's a copper compound. So copper hydroxide or copper oxychloride are the non-toxic versions of that Bordeaux mixture, which was copper sulfate. But also there are a few other organic materials and biodynamic materials that are very effective. One of my favourites is often the biodynamicists refer to boiled up leaves, funnily enough, boiled up leaves of a certain kind being a tea, right? So we use casuarina tea, and we got a few casuarina trees in the front yard of the house, and we boil that up, and that's a good replacement for sulfur. So you need some diversity in using these non-toxic substances.
That's very cool.
So it goes on. I mean, the one that's not known much, not a lot is talked about, is biodynamic potion 501. I think that one, that's the quartz.
501 is the second preparation, 500, yeah, 501.
Yeah, 500 is the cow dung.
Silica.
Yeah, it's silica.
Yeah.
Horn silica. And that is a magic ingredient in a damp.
So you always used that or at what stage did you decide like, okay, now?
Oh, I see. Yeah, well, I can't remember.
That's good science.
We started using completely non-toxic environment for fungicides in 93.
Mm.
Yeah, 2002 was when I started using
BD.
Kind
of thing. Mm-hmm. Pioneer, like you were.
There were a few around, you know, Julian Castagna, for example, and Vanya Cullen, and so there were quite a few dotted around who had started it before I did, and it was such an unknown subject, and you know, we all went to workshops and conferences, and I came out of thinking, well, why the hell did I waste my time there? but
a huge risk, and it's all worth it, no? Do you feel
the sensible thing is it's only a risk if you're not doing something you used to do which used to work. But no, it's because of the high pressure, fungal disease pressure where we are, that was where the risk lay. Thanks to somebody, it all worked.
Huge, yeah.
Mm.
We'll wrap up this episode of Got Some. Of course, we're going to be trying the 2015 Issan that we just spoke about, the fire property wine very soon. And we're also going to try, which is going to be amazing, the 2010 premium Pinot Noir. My last question for you for this episode, Phillip, is you mentioned that you sold Bass Phillip now.
Mm.
Can you take me through the emotion of that decision? Was it? I don't know your personal sense, if you have children, did it feel like you were saying goodbye to something that close? Because it is a body of work. We've heard about 50 years of work in these vineyards. We've talked about your hip replacement. That's because of your time spent in the grapes.
The sale process, forgetting about the emotion of not having all my favourite vines to play with, the sale process was one of the most confusing, frustrating, disappointing and upsetting experience I've ever had. And there are so many people, so-called professionals, who want to grab their little slice of whatever's happening, and then when they turn and be dishonest to your face, that's an experience I understand a lot of people have when they're trying to sell a business. And so that was point number one. Point number two is I was hoping to make a commitment to help the new owners carry on in a similar way, and through all I can say without, because I'm prevented from commenting on these things in any detail. All I can say is that through their actions, the relationship between myself and the Bass Phillip business terminated very rapidly within a few months of the sale. And I get phone calls from people who have been regular customers basically asking me what's going on, and I can't help my old customers. Right? So that frustrates me. In terms of not having, 12 to 15 hours a day of work, 7 days a week for almost the entire year to do, I'm not displeased about that.
Yeah, I don't think your body and your wife aren't either.
That's right. No, she's exceptionally happy. we'll see what happens. We'll see what happens. And
so you're not at the point of being too bitter that you won't try the first vineyard that you don't have your hands literally in the mix? You still want to see your brand progress? Because a lot of people, if they do have a similar relationship, they're done with that brand. They won't do it. Like, for example, like, you know, if you sold I've got a friend of mine who sold a business that went a little bit pear-shaped with his co-owner, and now he won't have anything to do with that business, won't check out their new merch, won't do anything, will never wear it again. For you, you'll still see what your pride and joy, this your legacy is producing?
I don't feel it's my responsibility. I would love to have made a contribution to it in the future, and I could have done that easily, you know, one eye closed. The style of that place will shine through no matter what. That's a good thing.
It's hard to muck up such good grapes.
The DNA of that business can't be changed.
Yeah, literally.
And it's, you know, yeah, it's where
people, as an expectation, I guess, yeah, for all the wines were before they were, obviously, the winery was purchased. And that's why the wines became what they are, right? And they're so, always so lively, so much character. And every bottle you open, you're just excited to pull the cork off.
No, it's very kind.
You know, and pour them in the glass because you just never know what to expect, but you know it's going to be an amazing experience every time.
And a poignant end to this, because we are going to pop the corks off a couple of bottles of Bass Phillip on the next episode of Got Some, with Phillip Jones sitting next to us, the winemaker. This is going to be an exciting part. Thank you so much for sharing some of the history of, you know, the beauty of what you created. And up next we get to actually try it out again and talk more in depth about the bottles in front of us and also the different levels of Bass Phillip wines. So stick around, everyone. The next episode of Got Some, we'll be still here with Phillip Jones.